This is James Taylor, and you're listening to The Creative Life. The Creative Life podcast is a show created for you, the creative. If you're looking for inspiration, motivation, and advice while at home, at work, or on your daily commute, then this show is for you. Each episode brings you a successful creative, whether that's a musician, writer, artist, designer, performer, educator, or creative entrepreneur. They share their journey, their successes, their failures, their creative process, their insights, and much, much more. In this episode of The Creative Life, I talk with New York TV and film composer Pete Calandra, and we cover the two kinds of musicians, the 10% rule of playing Broadway shows, the idea of filmmaking as a collaborative project, composing for the backstory, how to communicate with a film director as a composer, and music in the service of the story. Enjoy the episode. Hey, it's James Taylor, and I'm delighted today to have my guest Pete Calandra. And Pete is a New York-based composer and keyboard player. He has scored over 50 films, written over 2,000 compositions for television and film broadcast, and performed as a musician in the Broadway productions of Miss Saigon, The Lion King, Les Miserables, and Little Shop of Horrors. His most recent album is called First Light, a recording of instrumental music encompassing New Age, jazz, classical, and refined pop. As a keyboard player, he has performed with Aretha Franklin, Allen Ginsberg, and Dee Dee Bridgewater, to name just a few. And when asked about the wide range of genres his music covers, he says, "I don't try to define anything because I find that as a creative person, when you put something in a box, you limit the creative flow." So, Pete, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. How are you doing today?
Great. Wonderful. And share with our listeners, what's going on in your world just now? What current projects have you got happening?
Well, right now I have a few things going on. For the next 2 months, I'll be working on two pretty good-sized projects for ESPN. One is a 30 for 30 documentary about a female athlete named Ruthie Barnes. And we finished a 30-minute version of the film last week, and ESPN liked it so much that they actually want to expand the film out to an hour. So we'll be working on that, my filmmaking friends and myself. And then right after that, I'll be writing music for 6 or 8 short bio films about for the Invictus Games, which I think is Prince William.
I think it's Prince William or Prince Harry. Yeah, that's correct.
Prince Harry. It's one of their goodwill things. It's sort of like the Special Olympics for Wounded Warriors. And that broadcast is going to be taking place on ESPN on the second week of May. So it's a lot to do over the next 2 months, but that's what's happening right now.
And how did you first kind of learn your craft as a keyboard player and also as a composer as well? Where did it all start for you?
It started very young, maybe 5 or 6 years old. We got a piano in the house. My mother had played piano as a child, and she always wanted a piano. So we got a piano, and then I started picking out things by ear, and I had some piano lessons for a while, and then continued on with that course of action. And then sort of when I was in maybe like about 14 or 15, I really started to become interested in music and decided that it's what I wanted to pursue full time. So I went to music school. I went to Queens College at City University of New York. I have a bachelor's and a master's degree from there. And I started playing in bar bands before that when I was about 16 and played all sorts of music, top 40, jazz, blues, funk, soul, reggae, whatever I could. I paid my way through college playing in bar bands. And then when I was about, right after I got out of undergraduate school, I started subbing at the original Little Shop of Horrors off-Broadway show on the keyboard book. And then within 8 months, I got hired full-time, and I stayed there for 5 years for the rest of the run of the show. And that sort of launched my entire career.
And then when did the move into writing for TV and film, when did that happen?
Well, while I was working at Little Shop of Horrors playing keyboards, I started really developing my skills recording and sequencing music with little hardware sequencers and a 4-track Porta Studio cassette deck. And I worked with a bunch of singers, and I would produce and write with them. Then I sort of picked up my first computer in 1991 or 92. It was a Mac LC2, and I started sequencing there. And I was always writing music. I've always been writing music. And then I sort of fell in with someone who was working creating library music, and they were looking for more composers. So I did that production music, you know, writing tracks for like topical albums that were then sent off to broadcasters to be placed in television and film. So I would work on an acid jazz CD and write a bunch of 2-minute acid jazz tracks, or a drama CD, or retail, or sports highlights, or comedy. And so I spent about 4 or 5 years doing that, writing constantly, producing, you know, two or three tracks a week for like four or five years. And it was great training, because I was getting paid to learn how to write and record music, film and television music. And then once I had done that for a while, I built up a portfolio, and I started applying for some film jobs. And I started doing films around 2002, I think, was the first film I actually scored. And I've sort of, everything sort of evolved from that into what I'm doing.
And so you were able to, On the composing side, you were kind of doing that during the day, and then the evenings you were kind of going out doing playing on the Broadway shows.
Right. So from 19, like the last time I had a full time show was Miss Saigon, which ended in 15 years ago, actually January 28th of 2001. So from about 1997 till then, I was doing both. I would spend like 6 or 7 hours during the day writing, and then go off and play my show in the evening. And then once the show closed, I decided I wanted to pursue this full time. So I still play part time on Broadway. I substituted The Lion King, and that sort of vacillates between, you know, being there a couple of times a week to being there a couple of times a month. It depends on their schedule and my schedule. So I keep my fingers in that, and I keep doing that. But once Miss Saigon closed, I decided that I wanted to pursue this full time, and I've just spent all my energies working on this craft.
And something I'm always interested in players that do West End or Broadway shows, those kind of, I don't know whether if you call them in the States pit jobs.
Yeah
we call them.
Yes,
pits.
Actually, it's interesting, because when before we started cast rehearsals for Miss Saigon, I flew over to England and I watched the show a couple of times in the pit in the West End there I think it was December of 1990. And then I watched the show in the house a couple of times. So I got to experience the English pit.
The languages they were doing. I don't know whether they have it also in the States, where in the UK, I remember being with a pit musician, and we were just looking at a theatre he was in during the day before the show opened, and he was pointing up to the boxes, you know, the really expensive boxes that you'll have in any theatre. And his name for them were the ashtrays. I don't know.
That's pretty funny. We don't quite have those, because actually by now all the pits are very covered over by the lip of the stage. They're not open it like they used to be, because for multiple reasons. One reason is that they want the action to sort of seem like it's coming out into the audience and increase the depth perception on the stage. And the other reason being is that the producers completely want to do away with musicians. So if you can't get used to not seeing the musicians and get used to amplified sound, it's just a short step to like not having musicians at all in the pit, which is really kind of the effect it has is it makes pit working in pits being very unpleasant, because you don't have a sense of being part of the crowd. You're sort of blocked in. One of the incredible things about being in the original Little Shop of Horrors from 1982 until 1987 was that the band, even though it was only four musicians because it was an off-Broadway show, the band was actually in the house.
Yeah,
I started off there playing the keyboard book, which was electric piano, organ, and synthesizer. And then I moved over and I played the piano book and I conducted the show for the last 2.5 years of the run. And literally, I could reach over and touch an audience member. Or if I was playing piano, every once in a while, like, you know, an audience member would like tap me on the shoulder and ask me a question while in between songs. So it was the kind of experience where you felt like you were part of the performance as opposed to being shut into a little box playing your instrument and watching a TV monitor to follow the conductor because you can't look up to see him without straining your neck.
And when you're doing, you know, you're doing those shows, it's the same tunes that you're playing night after night after night. How do you stay interested? How do you stay sharp when you're having to do that? Because I would imagine a lot of musicians, that would be, they might be able to get through the first couple of weeks, but then doing these longer periods where they're having to do that, they may stray slightly and their playing may become maybe a little bit sloppy. So how do you stay interested in what you're doing?
It's a very good question, and one that I've kind of struggled with, because one thing I learned is that there are two kinds of musicians. Well, there are a lot of kinds of musicians, but there are musicians that are recreative musicians, and they play written music. And there's a lot of creativity in that. You can have a lot of choices that you make in terms of how you perform a piece of music. And then there's creative musicians who, like myself, are much more interested in the act of creating something from scratch. And it made it at times very difficult for me to sit in the pit when I had to play the same notes every night in sort of like 90%. You know, if you play the show, is every show is should be within 10% the same from night to night. You know, there's going to be variances. Somebody might have a little more energy one night on stage, so you might have to play something a little faster to keep up with them, or you might have, they might be a little bit less, the company might, and the musicians as well might be a little bit less energetic, so the conductor has to drag the musicians along, and it becomes a really interesting experiment to see like how you can get it up every night to play. One of the things you do is you take off and you get involved in other projects. You sub your show out, and so that you're not, it's not the only thing that you're doing. That's becoming much more difficult because there's less and less work to do, but there's something to be said for having a life outside the show so that it's not the only thing in your life and the only thing that you focus on every day, because it can become very, 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 very difficult to just expend that much energy on something. It's like reading the same page in the New York Times every day. You know, there's only so long that you can get something interesting out of it before you start to just sort of read through it. So it's an interesting challenge. But the other thing that you have to remember is that it's 2.5 to 3 hours a night, and people are paying a lot of money to sit in that orchestra, to sit in the theater and watch a show, and they don't have to spend that money to go do that, and they're paying your living.
Yeah.
So you really do need to be professional and just suck it up even when you're not into it. And if you find yourself that you're just going through a bad period of time where you can't, you know, you just don't want to be in there, and playing the same thing over and over again is driving you crazy, you take time off and you sub it out and you give another musician some work. And, you know, there's plenty of great musicians that are in need of work. And, you know, you sort of balance your life out like that.
And then this move into writing for TV and film, that must have been quite a liberating thing as well. So even if you're maybe writing for a director and they're giving you a certain type of brief, I would imagine there's a lot more kind of creativity involved in that, because you're creating the work, okay, albeit from a brief, or you're composing to picture.
Well, this is the way I look at that, is that filmmaking is a collaborative process, and it's also has a hierarchy to it. And the hierarchy starts at the top with the producer and the director, and then it filters down to like the film editor, the director of photography, and other people that are part of the team that's creating the project. So my job is to create the music. And the way I look at this is that the big part of my job is to make sure that the people that are hiring me are seen in the best light possible. And that's by giving them doing the best I can to see their vision of the project realized. And if they have very specific ideas about the music, it's up to me to do that the way they want it done. There's plenty of space within that paradigm for me to be creative. It's just a matter of understanding how the whole system works and fitting in. But the main thing is that once a project is finished, you go on to the next one. right? So I've been really fortunate that I've had an opportunity to write many different kinds of music in my film career. I did a film, another ESPN film, about a woman named Pat Summitt, who is a woman's, one of the greatest female college coach ever. She was the head women's basketball coach at the University of Tennessee for 30 years. She won a lot of NCAA tournaments. Just a great, great coach, great person. And I got to write a lot of Delta blues roots music for that film, which I actually play guitar, and I actually performed the entire score on my acoustic guitars. And then, you know, you contrast that with a couple of independent films I wrote in the about 10 years ago named Jelly Smoke and Unknown Soldier, where I got to do a jazz score with a small jazz combo, or an orchestral score for a film like Rise, or the films I'm working on now. The Ruthie film has a lot of ambient orchestral music. So that, you know, you could see already that there's all, even though all the music for all these films has a very specific direction that was mostly decided by the filmmakers, there is so much room for creativity to explore from project to project. And it's a great challenge and one that I really enjoy.
And how do you, when you've had that first kind of meeting with the director on a film and the team that are involved in a movie or a TV documentary, for example, what kind of questions are you asking them to find out what's maybe in their head and maybe the direction that you should be going musically when you're composing?
Well, I ask them if there's any other scores that they like that, or any other music that they've heard that might fit language-wise, not notes-wise, but, you know, as far as a language goes. We talk about what's the backstory in the film. Like, I read something once where the music I forget where I read this. It was in an article I read online about 10 years ago, that the music should at times not mimic the actual physical action, but the psychological action in a scene. And that's interesting. So you're basically trying to get into the mind of the characters and what they're experiencing and feeling and express that in the score. So sometimes in the case of the Pat Summitt film, the physical location, you know, being in Tennessee, that there's a certain kind of expectation about that music, the kind of person she was, very down home, very earthy. I did a documentary for Oprah Winfrey about her women's academy in South Africa. So the physical place of being in South Africa led the directors to want to have African instruments blended in with an orchestral score. So there's all sorts of ways that you go about that. But one thing that I find really helpful is to learn how to communicate with a director and to learn what they mean when they say something. And I've had, it's really interesting to do. So what I mean by that is a lot of film directors don't have any musical training, so you don't want to talk to them in musical terms. You don't want them to say things like, oh, it should be agitato, I want pizzicato, I want spiccato, I want accelerando. You don't talk to them in musical terms. You talk to them in emotional terms. Mm. You know, she's having an inner conflict here, a struggle between this situation and that situation, and how it's going to be rectified, and the music should move along here. You know, things where it's more descriptive, and then you need to learn how to translate those descriptions into music. And those descriptions are different from director to director.
So you're going to have you have to know kind of their makeup, almost their DNA of how they talk about things. So some directors may talk extremely visually around what they have as well, and other ones they use other more feeling, more kinesthetic kind of feelings that are kind of going on.
Exactly. Yes, that's so true, and that's part of your job.
Yeah. So you're a kind of translator in some ways as well, before you can even get into the actual creating the work.
You're a medium.
You're a medium. a film director medium. So you kind of go through this. I'm fascinated to you've gone through, you know, working with some incredible projects and a lot within sports as well.
Yes.
So how, tell me about the process of actually how many of the, you get many of these composition gigs. Where do they come from? Is it very much repeat business that, you know, people, you've worked with one music supervisor or one director and then they can book you again? How does it get happen?
Word of, so, well, there are composers, film composers and television composers that have agents. I'm not in that camp. I get all my work through word of mouth.
And was that a conscious decision not to go the agency route because you wanted to have that direct relationship?
No, it hasn't been an opportunity that's come across my plate. I'm New York City based, and I would say that there's probably not a lot of New York City based composers that have agents. Alan Menken certainly does. And Carter Burwell certainly does, but most of the people that work like that live in Los Angeles. They're Los Angeles based.
So you've had to kind of go out and forge your own path.
Yes, word of mouth and repeat business.
And with a new client that you haven't worked with before, a new director or music supervisor, what would you normally be sending them if they haven't heard about you? They've maybe heard about you slightly, but they don't know much about you, the kind of work that you've done. What are you sending to them?
Well, what I try to do is find out before I send something to anybody. I try to find out what their project is and what their vision for that project is, and then I have a folder with hundreds and hundreds of tracks of music that I've written, and I might put together a portfolio for them that's sort of based on what we've discussed, music I've written that's in that style or that I think would work. And I try to give them different options so that it's not all it's every track doesn't sound exactly the same. I'll go through my portfolio and I'll pick, oh, this could work. Let me, and I might even actually go back and open up a mix and move things around a little bit if I have something that's not so exact or that I don't think will work so well. So it's that, or I'll just send them to my SoundCloud page or my YouTube page and they can sort of scroll through things there. It's not one specific way.
And then talk to us about a time, maybe you worked on a project, you really put your heart and soul into the project, but for whatever reason, it didn't work out either like you'd hoped or the people that were commissioning the work. And what were the lessons that you took away from that experience?
Well, I don't know if I've ever had a project yet in the end that didn't work. But I've had some projects that were more difficult than others. And it's usually when you're not communicating well with the director, right? I don't really seem to have those kinds of issues now. I had them more when I was first starting out. And then I think one of the lessons that I learned was that I needed to learn how to communicate better on a different level with the people that I was working with. So for example, Unknown Soldier was a film that I scored in 2004 that won the Los Angeles Film Festival. It won the Philadelphia Film Festival. It played in festivals all over the world. Literally, if I said 70 or 80 festivals. It got nominated for Independent Spirit Award, which is the Academy Awards for independent films. And then eventually it got bought by Stars and Showtime, and it was on network. It was on cable television 8 or 9 times a month for like 3 or 4 years. So as far as an independent film goes, it was very successful. The film had a lot of problems, even the finished product. But what the film did very well was it told a story about homelessness in urban settings and in a way that was very sensitive. And when I was first working on the score, the director had all these different ideas about what he wanted the music to be, and I kept on trying to write music that he wanted And I couldn't, it everything he told me, it just, it was wrong. It didn't work. And I must have scored the opening scene 5 or 6 times. And finally, I just said, look, just come here and I'm going to write with you sitting here and we're going to work this out together. And I sat there and I put together a piece of music and, you know, I asked, do you like this? Do you not like this? And then once, so I sort of was like leading him by the hand through the composition process. And it was very difficult. It was very time consuming. And in the end, we ended up with something really good. But the rest of the film had some, you know, I ended up having some issues with the score because he wanted it to be every cue to have a different style of music to it. So, you know, it kind of makes it hard to have continuity in a score when every piece of music has a different sound to it. So I had to work, I had to figure out ways where there were melodic ideas and motifs that I could bring in. And if I did the same similar melody in an orchestral setting or an ambient setting, it worked with the jazz setting that was at the beginning of the film. So it was very difficult. And the thing I learned about that is about communication.
And in this journey that you've had as initially working in the pits, doing the kind of Broadway work, and then moving into TV and film and composing for that, can you tell us about any insights or light bulb moments, kind of those aha moments you have in your life where you say, okay, this is maybe the direction I need to be going with the creative work I'm doing, or this is a decision I need to be making at this point?
When I was much younger, I wanted to be a jazz pianist. I did whatever I had to do to get through college. And then once I got out of college, other opportunities started presenting themselves to me. I still pursued jazz when I was younger. I played with Don Cherry, played with Allen Ginsberg, doing, you know, jazz and poetry, some performances. And I was hooked up with this man named Larry Rivers, who's a very famous painter, artist, who also was a jazz tenor saxophone player, and he sung. And we had a jazz quintet. He was 30 years older than me. He was very well known in the art world. And I played in his group for 15 years. But aside from that, what seemed to happen to me, the doors that seemed to be open to me, were working in areas where the music that I was involved in was in service to telling a story. Being in a pit, the music is serving to tell the story of the show. Writing music for films and television, everything is about telling the story, telling stories in sound. And it just sort of seemed to move in that direction. And everything I've done, the years I spent playing in Broadway shows and off-Broadway shows has been very, very helpful to my film composing career, because on multiple levels. Because first of all, when I was in my early mid-20s and I was playing piano and conducting Little Shop of Horrors, it taught me about pacing and how to unfold a story, how to pace the music so that I reached certain dramatic moments, certain comedic moments in a certain time frame with a certain amount of energy. And that was very, very, very helpful. Sitting in a pit, playing in the Radio City Orchestra, playing on stage playing with the New York Pops with 80 musicians. I was actually, as a keyboard player, physically inside of an orchestra. And that's helped my composing tremendously to actually hear what a French horn is supposed to sound like, to actually hear what a great oboe sounds like, because I've worked with and know and have performed with some of the best musicians in New York City. And when you're sitting in an orchestra with people that, let's face it, the way the music industry is now, 30 years ago, playing in a Broadway show was considered pretty low work on the food chain. But the way it is now, it's considered very high work on the food chain because it's steady work for orchestral musicians or jazz musicians. And as a result, you get people that are sitting in Broadway shows that are highly overqualified for their positions, just unbelievably talented and great musicians that could be playing at the New York Philharmonic, that could be playing with Wynton Marsalis, that, you know, could be playing any top performing situation they could be involved in.
I guess it's a little bit like the film side, you know, with actors for years and years, TV was the poor relation to movies. Whereas now, you know, I was speaking to a number of actors recently and said, you know, the thing that they yearn for is getting that great television part, like, you know, the kind of homelands and the where they can take a character and expand it over multiple series as well. So for an actor, it's doing two things. One of it's you're getting to show your chops and develop your skills and develop the character. But you know, in terms of financially as well, it's actually quite a nice thing because it's a more kind of ongoing kind of income stream for you as well, especially if you're involved in a really great hit show.
Yeah, it's so true. It's so true. I agree with that 100%. And the side benefit for me is it was an additional education, right? You could listen to recordings, you could study orchestration books, but there's nothing like sitting in the middle of an orchestra. I mean, I've played piano on stage at Carnegie Hall with 80 musicians, right? The concert I did with Dee Dee Bridgewater, you know, it was with the New York Pops and the rhythm section, and we had, you know, 70 musicians on stage, full string section, brass section, rhythm section, woodwind section, orchestral percussion section. And, you know, there's other times I've been on stage with more than that. And just to hear that sound, hear, like, not as a recording, but to be in the middle of it, to be playing the piano and trying to blend in with the string section, to be playing like a synthesizer book in an orchestral situation and trying to fill out the brass but not overtake them, to learn how they breathe, to learn, you know, what are the difficult things for musicians to play, and listening to how some of the great orchestrators, how they work and what their work sounds like and how to distribute notes. I've learned all this stuff on the job. Now, when I'm working in composing for films and television, a vast majority of what's going on now is virtual instruments, using sample-based libraries to write and record, and then layering acoustic instruments on top of that. Well, that only works well when you're making the sampled instruments sound as close to the real thing as possible, and you have to learn how to animate the sound so it moves like a real player would do, to breathe like a real player would breathe, and you don't write things that are idiomatically not correct for an instrument to play. You know, huge jumps in brass instruments, you know, things like that. Learn what the right range is, where the powerful range for a French horn is. If you want a big epic sports theme, you know, you don't want the sound to be up the upper register. You want it to be right in the middle register of a French horn, so it's very powerful. All these things that you learn, that I've learned on sort of from my performing career. And it's been very, very, very helpful for me.
I remember when some of the first kind of keyboard synthesizers came out and they had string pads on them, string sounds on them, and they never sounded quite right. And it was only kind of later when they improved upon them. One of the things I kind of heard was that thing that all string sections do, where no string section attacks right from the very start of the note. They don't glide into the note, but in terms of volume level, so a lot of those early keyboards, the attack on the sound of the strings was like really hard, like just not what a real string section would do.
Yeah, well, that's you know, I would venture to say that there are very few film scores that you hear now that are completely acoustic.
So they're layering in those
something, yeah, because especially with the big films, you want to make them sound hyper real, right? Bigger than life. And given the way that budgets are now, I would say a vast majority of films, even if they sound completely acoustic, are acoustic instruments layered on top of the sampled version. And, you know, you play along to a click track and you sync all the timing up that way.
And so as you've developed this, learning this kind of both the craft and the artistry of film and TV composition, what's some of the best advice that you've ever received from maybe others in the industry or people that you admire that have kind of told you something that you've kind of kept and you've held on to?
Try to create something that's unique. Don't try to be the next John Williams. Try to be the first you.
So people are going to get to know you have a style, and they kind of begin to hire you for your style.
So even though I've written music in a lot of different genres, It all comes from my perspective. I'm not trying to copy somebody else. Even if I've been given music that stylistically is where the filmmaker wants the score to go, I still always approach it like what's from my sensibilities to add my own unique vision to it. That, and the other thing I would say for anybody else is to learn technology to the as like it's an instrument. Learn how to play the computer like it's an instrument. I'm also on the faculty of my alma mater, Queens College, City University of New York, and I teach music technology and film scoring and composition there as an adjunct. And I know how to engineer, record, and mix all my albums. I engineer all the instruments on them. I record them in my own space. I've mixed many of my film scores, although if I have the budget, I prefer to ship that out to somebody else who's a proper mix engineer to do it. And when we do some of the larger projects like the FIFA World Cup theme I wrote for Fox Sports and the Special Olympics World Game theme that I wrote for ESPN, we go to a proper studio and I have a proper engineer with microphones and everything like that do it. But I can do all that stuff myself additionally. And I think that all these skill sets are so invaluable to being a film and television, to anybody working in a creative field these days, musically. You can't sit at a piano and bang out a melody to a director. You know, the tools are there, they're available. You can create an entire film score in a laptop right now, or with a couple of Mac minis networked together using software. So,
and while we're talking about tools, do you have any online resources or tools like Evernote or Pro Tools that you absolutely love and you don't think you could live without now?
Pro Tools, I use Pro Tools for everything, although that may be changing this year as Avid, the company, is really making it difficult to stay involved with Pro Tools on a full-time level. So I'm starting to explore some of the other digital audio workstations out there. But I love Pro Tools, the software, especially when working with audio. It's fantastic. And I've learned to live with its MIDI shortcomings. There's a piece of software called Vienna Ensemble, which is a great piece of software which enables you to network computers together over the Ethernet, which is really, really, really made it possible to expand the amount of memory and RAM that you can use to create your orchestral work.
Those are the kind of two of the tools of your trade. And if you could recommend just one record and book to our listeners, what would they be?
That would be. That's a very difficult question, because I don't think there is one record. I think that there's...
Is there a record that you've gifted more to other people?
I don't really know. I mean, depending upon the genre. I mean, I could say that like John Coltrane, A Love Supreme, is one of my favorite albums. Bill Evans' Sunday at the Village Vanguard is fantastic. There's some Miles Davis that's incredible. The score for Vertigo is unbelievably great. Jerry Goldsmith has some incredible scores. There's like, you know, so I, B.B. King live at the Regal is unbelievable. The Allman Brothers live at the Fillmore. I could go on and on with all these different, anything by the Beatles, you know, I could go on and
let's
on.
Let's make it easier. What about a book? What would the book be?
What would the book be? Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance.
Oh, yeah.
We're On the Road by Jack Kerouac. Those are two of my, and also the J.D. Salinger book that's banned everywhere. Catcher in the Rye. Those are three of my favorite books.
And finally, imagine if you woke up tomorrow morning and had to start from scratch. So all you've got is the tools of your trade. So you're talking about Pro Tools and there's some of those other tools, keyboards, and the knowledge that you've acquired over the years, but no one knows who you are and you've got to start from scratch. What would you do? How would you restart?
Well, you'd have to start networking. The only way people are going to hire you is if they know who you are.
And what's the best way to network in your part of the industry and in your part of music?
Well, I've always looked at networking. I think that networking, people look at networking as I meet somebody and what can they do for me, right? But I look at networking as making friends and what can I do for my friends, right? So I have most of the filmmakers I work with, I consider them to be my friends. And what can I do to make them look the best to create the best work possible so that they look good to the people that are hiring them so that they'll hire me again. So it's not about what I can get from them. It's about what I can give to them.
Yeah.
You know, you're in service, right? You're in service. One other piece of gear that I would be hard to live without also is, you were missing in mentioning, is my Yamaha DC7A conservatory grand piano. I can't, since I'm a Yamaha artist, I have to mention that.
You've got to mention it as well. Well, Pete, thank you so much. What is the best way that listeners can connect with you and check out your music? And we didn't even get a chance to talk about the latest album, First Light, as well, so people can kind of go and hear that and find out more about your other projects.
Yes, so I'm on the web at PeteCalandraMusic.com. PeteCalandraMusic.com. You can also find me on Twitter, on Facebook, on SoundCloud. Those are the standard places that everybody is these days.
Wonderful. Well, Pete, thank you so much for coming on the show. I wish you all the best with these two new projects you've got coming up as well. Look forward to hopefully hearing them as well when they come on TV. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a great day. Great, great, great hour.
Hey, James Taylor here again. And if you're interested in living a more creative life, then I'd love to invite you to join me as I share some of the most successful strategies and techniques that high-performing creatives use. I put them all together in a free downloadable ebook that you can get by going to jamestaylor.me. That's jamestaylor.me to get your free downloadable ebook on creativity.